belongs to all of us. So we are reclaiming our time. I am so delighted to be here with you this evening, and I want you to know, just sitting there watching all of these young people with all of this energy, I know that we're going to win. Give yourselves a big round of applause. Allow me first to introduce my table. I have family and staff and friends here with me this evening. First, meet my husband, Ambassador Sidney Williams. My daughter, Karen Waters. My district director here in Los Angeles, Blanca Jimenez. Nicole Robinson, executive assistant. Hamilton Clow, special projects coordinator. And my dear friend who worked with us for over 10 years, but he left me. He's here with me tonight. He is the director of service programs for the Little Tokyo Service Center, Mike Marassi. I'd like now to acknowledge the president of the Korean Resource Center, that is KRC, and the co-director of the National Korean American Service and Education Consortium, that is NAKASAC, that is DJ Young, co-director. Co-director NAKASAC, Becky Belcour, and all the board of directors and the staffs of KRC and NAKASAC. And I'd like to thank Angela Oh for that very kind and generous introduction. She is someone that we all admire. She's a hard worker. She's been at it for a long time. Let's give her a big round of applause. Angela Oh. So ladies and gentlemen, it is such a tremendous honor to be here tonight to celebrate the work of the Korean Resource Center and the National Korean American Service and Education Consortium. For more than 30 years, these organizations have worked tirelessly to advocate for people of color, particularly Asian American and Pacific Islander communities in Southern California and all across the country. I'm delighted to be here, and I'm pleased to be recognized. But I want to tell you, Don Howard, who is your guest speaker this evening, is a tremendous resource and a wonderful leader and a progressive leader. Let's give Don Howard a big round of applause. All of the awardees that have been recognized here this evening are very special people because of the work that they do, of the sacrifices that they make, and the fact that they understand that we have a right to participate in this country, that we are strong supporters of the democracy, and we're going to demand justice and equality. So you give our honorees here this evening a big round of applause. Lisa Blue, Community in Action Award. Jeanette Vasquez, Community in Action Award. Samira Ho, Dreamer in Action Award. Pauline, John Kim, Dreamer in Action Award. Eric Lunson, Dreamer in Action Award. A big round of applause for all of our awardees here this evening. So ladies and gentlemen, whether it was organizing advocates, protesting in front of the White House, or ensuring that Korean and Pacific Islander families have the resources they need to safely integrate into this community, KRC and NAKASAC are working to strengthen our democracy every day. This legacy is certainly something to be proud of, and I ask that you join me in saluting them for their terrific service. Another round of applause. And so you know that I am so delighted and humbled to be the recipient of the Standing Up for Justice Award. I'm so proud to be your champion in the United States Congress, and it is my hope that my advocacy continues to make a difference in the lives of people in our community, the 43rd Congressional District that I represent, and Asian Americans all across this country. To me, standing up for justice is not something one does occasionally or when it is politically expedient. Truly, standing up for justice requires diligence and unwavering commitment, because the threat of unfairness, discrimination, and inequality are always present in any society. Standing up for justice is something that I know many of you are doing each and every day, and I'm so proud to stand with you. Our country is enduring a very strange and peculiar moment in our history. The circumstances we're facing require that each citizen be relentless in the pursuit of justice. We are now faced with the most unqualified and dishonorable man to ever serve in the office of the presidency, Donald Trump. In merely 9 months, or 272 days, this president and his administration have pursued a series of racist, anti-immigrant, and in some cases, unconstitutional policies that are contrary to everything our democracy stands for. One of Donald Trump's first major actions as president was to roll out the so-called travel ban, which targeted immigrants from majority Muslim countries. You may recall the heartbreaking stories of the victims this ban, children, university students, professors, doctors, seniors, and all of whom were denied entry into this country at no fault of their own. It was not because of something they had done. It was because of where they came from. I will never forget joining the thousands of fellow protesters at LAX who immediately rushed down to the Tom Bradley International Terminal to show our love and support for thousands of people who were being targeted by such a blatant, xenophobic, ill-conceived, and unconstitutional travel ban. We also can't forget that Donald Trump bypassed the traditional review process to pardon Arizona Sheriff Joe Arpaio, who is one of the most overt racists to recently serve in a public office. Arpaio is notorious for his cruel campaign against undocumented immigrants and was convicted of violating the constitutional rights of Latinos, stopping people based on illegal racial profiling, and detaining some of them solely on the suspicion that they were in the country illegally. Instead of disavowing Arpaio for his racist and unconscionable behavior, Trump pardoned him, ensuring that his ally would face no time in prison for his crimes committed against people of color and for contempt of the United States Constitution. Unfortunately, it doesn't end there. Donald Trump and his Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, have continued their assaults on immigrant communities for their own political gain. This administration has proposed using taxpayer dollars to fund a senseless border wall. They have attacked sanctuary cities and states like California and continuously advocated for harsh and drastic changes to our legal immigration system. Most recently, Donald Trump and Jeff Sessions turned their attention to more than 800,000 beneficiaries of the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, that is the DACA program. These are young people who came to America as children who are innocent of any wrongdoing. Often, these individuals were unaware of their immigration status. In most cases, America is the only home they have ever known. Thanks to DACA, they were able to come out of the shadows. They registered with the government, paid a fine, underwent background checks, enrolled in college, found good paying jobs, and unlike the this dishonorable, despicable president. They even paid their fair share of taxes. However, this president and his attorney general callously uprooted the Dreamers' entire sense of stability, leaving them more at risk and uncertain about their futures than ever before by putting an expiration date on the DACA program. Donald Trump and Jeff Sessions' actions on DACA demonstrate a complete lack of care or compassion. None of this should come as a surprise. This is who Donald Trump is and always will be. He announced his campaign in a speech where he called Mexican immigrants rapists and criminals. He then traveled all around the country, lying to his base in order to make them believe that immigrants and people of color were the cause of their plight. As Donald Trump parades across this country, claiming that he and he alone will make America great again, what he really needs to understand is that immigrants to this country have already done more to make this country great than he ever will. Taking a look at the contributions of Korean Americans to the United States, over 1.7 million Korean Americans live in the United States. There are more than 333,000 in California. Many Koreans settled right here in Los Angeles. This year marks the 135th anniversary of Korean immigration to the United States. As Koreans immigrated to this country, they brought with them an exceptional drive and entrepreneurial spirit that exemplifies the American dream. Nearly half of Korean immigrants to the United States opened their own businesses, spanning various service and retail specialists. According to the Los Angeles Times, Korean businesses represent at least a third and possibly half of the businesses right in our garment industry, generating at least $10 billion in annual revenues and providing 20,000 jobs. That's enough for us. Big applause. Come on. More broadly, according to the Department of Commerce's Minority Business Development Agency, Asian American-owned firms generate over $500 billion in revenue. They also create 208 million jobs per year. This outstanding impact is particularly beneficial to cities such as my district, Torrance and Gardena, and all across the state of California, which have thriving Korean and Japanese American communities. That is why I say to all of those who have been affected by Trump's inhumane, reprehensible, and anti-immigrant actions, I stand with you. To the more than 200,000 DACA recipients living in California, 50,000 of whom are children who live here in LA County and will soon be eligible for DACA, I want you to know I have your back. And my Democratic colleagues in the House and Senate also have your back. We're fighting every day to hold Donald Trump and his Republican allies on Capitol Hill accountable. And we're fighting to ensure that we pass a bipartisan fix for DACA before the clock runs out. As I close, I want you to know that I remain confident that our best days are ahead of us. This is largely due to the work of organizations like KRC and NACASAC and many others who are getting involved in the fight to protect immigrants, people of color, seniors, veterans, LGBTQT people, Americans with disabilities, and many other communities who are at risk under this president. We cannot be shut up or shut down by a racist bully. During this unprecedented period in our history, our resolve must be to continue standing up for justice, not just for some, but for all of us. So I would like to thank you and applaud you and encourage you to continue keeping your neighbors informed, organizing your communities, registering people to vote, and most importantly, showing up. The America that I know and love is more powerful than any one deplorable man and the white nationalists that he's courting from the White House. The American people understand that our diversity is our greatest strength, and we will not allow Donald Trump to destroy the very thing that has made this country the greatest nation on earth. And so, ladies and gentlemen, there are those who continue to believe that somehow he is going to become presidential, that somehow he's going to transition and be a better person than he has shown himself to be. I don't believe that. I believe, again, that this despicable and deplorable man must be removed from office. I'm calling for his impeachment. That he's been in collusion with the Russians and the Kremlin and with Putin and the oligarchs of Russia, and that our special counsel is going to connect the dots. It is just a matter of time before the facts will be before our eyes, and even those Republicans who support him today are going to have to stand with us if they are as patriotic as they claim to be, and they're going to have to join me in calling for his impeachment. Of justice. He obstructed justice right before our very eyes when he shared classified information with the Russians in the White House. And in addition to that, his firing of Comey is a great indication of what we're going to learn about how he has obstructed justice. And so, whether it is collusion or obstruction of justice, or that he's violating the Constitution, or because of the emoluments law, or whether it is because he and his family have been found just today to have retweeted all of those ads that were bought on Facebook and Twitter by the Russians, and we found that Junior and Kushner and all of them were retweeting, and so that in itself is collusion. And so I'm convinced that we can take our America back from him. The work that you're doing, the work that you're putting together for all of us in this country, the trips that you're going to make to Washington, D.C., the voice that you have created for justice and equality will reign in this country. I believe that no matter how difficult it seems at night when you go to bed, wondering what you're going to wake up to the next day, wondering what he tweeted at 3 a.m. in the morning, that after a good night's sleep, you wake up as I do, and you feel that the fight is on, and we're not gonna back up, we're not gonna give up, we're not gonna walk away. As a matter of fact, we are woke, and we're all gonna stay woke. Stay woke.